Okay, the Torah portion today is Mishpatim, and it can be translated as ordinances or judgments. It's found in Exodus 21, verse 1 through Exodus chapter 24, verse 18. The Haftarah portion is 2 Kings chapter 12, verse 1 through verse 17. And in other Bibles, it would be in chapter 11, verse 21 through chapter 12, verse 16. And the Brit Hadashah portion is Luke chapter 7, verse 1 through Luke chapter 8, verse 3. And first, we'll take a quick look at the pictograms and the gematria. And we'll briefly go through some of these scriptures here and see how they point to Yeshua HaMashiach. And we'll start with that now. So the first letter of the word Mishpatim is a mem. And the pictogram of the mem represents water. And it means either chaos or mighty or blood. And we can read about the references to this in John chapter 4, John chapter 7, and 1 John chapter 5. So I'll just have Leonardo read in 1 John chapter 5. And we'll read. I'll try and cut this down a little bit so we can get to the Torah portion rather quickly. 1 John chapter 5, go ahead and read verse 4 through 12. No, 4 through 13. Chapter 5, verse
12 through 14.
Now, what did I tell you?
4 through 13. Okay. For everyone born of God overcomes the world, and the victory that has overcome the world is this, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world, if not the one who believes that Yeshua has been Elohim? Messiah Yeshua is the one who came by water and blood, not by water only, but by water and blood. The Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three are one. If we accept God's testimony is greater, For this, it is the testimony that God has given about his Son. The one who trusts in being Elohim has the testimony in himself. The one who does not trust in God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has given about his Son. And the testimony is this, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. The one who has the Son has life. The one who does not have Ben Elohim does not have life. I wrote these things to you who believe in the name of Ben Elohim, so you may know that you have eternal life. Now this is the confidence we have before him, that if we do ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we will have the request we have asked from him. If anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he should ask, and God will give life to those who commit sin not leading to death. There is a sin leading to death. I am not saying you should ask about that. All unrighteousness is sin, but there is sin not leading to death. Through 7.
Okay, you stop there. Okay, the next letter is the letter Shin. And for the Jewish people, what does the letter Shin represent? Represents El Shaddai, Hashem, represents God. So Angela, could you go ahead and read Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 through 10?
Yep. See that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception, according to the tradition of men and the basic principles of the world rather than Messiah. For all the fullness of deity lives bodily in him, and in him you have been filled to fullness. He is the head over every ruler and authority.
Okay, now the next letter of the word Mishpatim is the letter Pei, right? And the pictogram of the letter Pei is a mouth. And so Debbie, could you go to Matthew chapter 17 and go ahead and read verse 1 through 13.
And after 6 days, Yeshua takes Peter, James, and John, his brother, and brings them up to a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them. And his face did shine as the sun, and his clothes were white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with them. Then answered Peter and said to Yeshua, Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you will, let's make you 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And while he was speaking, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud that said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Yeshua came and touched them and said, Arise and don't be afraid. And when they lifted up their eyes, they only saw. They didn't see any man, they saw only Yeshua. And as they came down from the mountain, Yeshua charged them, saying, Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. And his disciples asked him, saying, Why then say the scribes that Elijah must first come? And Yeshua answered and said unto them, Elijah truly shall first come and restore all things. But I say to you that Elijah has come already, and they knew him not. But have done unto him whatsoever they wanted. Likewise also said the Son of Man suffer of them. Then the disciples understood he spake unto them of John the Baptist.
Okay.
Yochanan the Immerser.
Okay, the next letter we have in the word Mishpatim is the letter Tet. And the letter Tet is a clay basket. But it also references, with the number 9, it references finality and judgment. And so, Leonardo, can you go ahead and read Acts chapter 10, verse 38 to 43, and we'll see scriptures telling us that Yeshua HaMashiach is the judge.
You know how God anointed Yeshua of Nazareth with the Ruach HaKodesh and power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, because God was with him. Yep. We are witnesses to all he did, both in the Judean countryside and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him up on the third day and caused him to be visible, not to all the people, but to us, witnesses, who were chosen beforehand by God. We ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to proclaim to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who puts his trust in him receives forgiveness of sin through his name.
Okay. Now, the next letter in Mishpatim is the letter Yud. Okay. And the letter Yud is a hand, and it means work, throw, or worship. And Yeshua HaMashiach in John chapter 1, we can put that also down here, says in John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and without Him, what? Nothing was made that was made. And then in verse 14, it tells us that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. I'll have Angela read Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 through 18.
He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by Him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, the seen and unseen. Whether thrones or angelic powers or rulers or authorities, all was created through Him and for Him. He is the head of the body, His community. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that He might come to have first place in all things.
Okay. The last letter we have is another mem, or a final mem. And that goes back to the water again. And if you read John chapter 4 and John chapter 7, you'll see how Yeshua HaMashiach refers to Himself as the living water. And when we go through the gematria of the word Mishpatim, the number 40 represents a time of testing and trial. We know that in the time of Noah, that it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. We know that Moses went up on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights, two different times. We know that the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. We know that Yeshua HaMashiach was tempted by the adversary in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. The letter Shin is the number 300, and the number 300 is a reference to the faithful remnant and ties in with Gideon's army. The number 80 is the age that Moses was when he led the children of Israel out of the wilderness, and that was just what? Couple weeks ago, right? And we said before the number 9 represents finality and judgment. The number 10 represents the 10 words, the words of creation, the 10 words at Mount Sinai. The number 10 is also for the minyan. We also know that Jacob's wages were changed by Laban 10 times. Abraham went through 10 trials. The children of Israel tried God in the wilderness 10 times. So there's a lot of tens all through the scripture. And then we have the number 40 again. When we come down here, there's two different gematrias for the word Mishpatim, because the final mem can be 40 or 600. And so the zero represents eternity, the one is Hashem, the two is the two tablets, the number 3 is the Father, Son, and Spirit, or man made up of what? Body, soul, and spirit. The number 3 also refers to the Torah, the writings, and the prophets. Also represents the threefold cord. Also, everything is established in the mouth of what? Two or three witnesses. And there's many cases where the number 3 comes up, especially 3 days all through the Tanakh and the Brit Hadashah. We know that Jonah was in the fish for 3 days. We know one of the plagues of Egypt, that they were in what? The plague of darkness. We know that Yeshua was in the tomb for 3 days and 3 nights. And the number 3 is found all through Scripture. The number 4 represents creation. The number 7 represents completion. 9, we said, was judgment. The number 20 was the age a person had to be counted in the census. And the number 13 here is the gematria for the word ahava, which is love. And actually, when we look at this Torah, Mishpatim, ordinances and judgments, some people think, well, judgments, that it's a bad thing. Well, actually, no, because we're going to find out in this Torah portion that the judgments are actually about Hashem's love and mercy and grace. Mm-hmm. Because, yes, offenders have to be judged to protect the other people, right? So he, by judging those that are guilty, Hashem is protecting the people that are righteous, isn't he? So he's showing love to his people by judging the people that disobey. Mm-hmm. And we'll see that right as we start this Torah portion. He'll be judging somebody that's disobedient, but he'll also be showing his love and mercy to that person.
Kind of like with our children, we have to discipline.
There has to be discipline.
Otherwise, we really don't love them.
Right. And so now we'll get into this Torah for the Mishpatim. We'll go to Exodus 21, verse 1. And as we study this chapter, we'll really see that at the beginning of the chapter, you have this English word, it's a conjunction, the word end. So where this chapter starts, remember that in the Torah scroll, there are no chapters and verses. And so the beginning of chapter 21 is actually a continuation of what Hashem was teaching about in chapter 20. We also have to understand that the nation of Israel is, in this time period, a theocracy. It's all under, okay, everything is under Hashem. So all of the Lord's rules and regulations, ordinances and judgments, commandments, they're all from Hashem. Okay, there in Israel, okay, at this time there is no separation of church and state, as modern day men would call it. All the people of Israel are under the one true God, Hashem, and all the rules and regulations, ordinances and judgments all come from Hashem.
The whole government's from God.
The whole government is from Hashem. And there isn't anything that's done outside his rules and regulations, right? It's not man's rules and man's government and man's laws. It's Hashem's laws. So we'll start out and we'll read verse. Leonardo, could you go ahead and read chapter 21, verse 1 through 6?
Now these are the ordinances which you will set before them. if you buy a Hebrew servant, he is to serve for 6 years. And in the seventh, he is to go free without payment. If he comes in by himself, he is to go out by himself. If he was married, then his wife will go out with him. If his master gave him a wife and she bears him sons or daughters, the wife and her children will be her master's, and he will go free by himself. But if the servant plainly states, I love my master, my wife, and my children, and I will not go out free, then his master is to bring him to God.
To the court.
Huh?
To the court, yeah.
Okay, to the court. Mine says God, yeah. Okay. Bring him to the court, then take him to a door or to a doorpost. His master is to pierce his ear through an awl, and he will serve him forever. If a man sells his daughter to
me... I'll stop there.
Okay.
Okay, so now we're talking about this servant. Actually, here in the Hebrew translation, it calls the man a bondsman. Okay? A Jewish person, Hebrew person, Israelite, cannot be a slave. Right? The Jewish people are not allowed to own each other or own a Jewish slave, okay? So the first thing we see here, this man is a bondsman, okay? He's not a slave. And the next thing is that if you continue from the teachings in the previous chapter where Hashem was teaching, he talked about a thief. And so here when we're talking about this particular bondsman, we're talking about a thief. Okay? And this person becomes a bondsman because he was a thief. He's stolen property from somebody. Okay, so he's caused somebody a monetary loss, and he's been taken to the court to be judged. And I believe what happens in this case, either it could be, what, a Jewish man that's single, or it could be a man that has a wife and a family. I believe what happens in this case, okay, the man is taken to court and there's a judgment against the man, okay, because he's a thief. The judge makes a determination what this man has to do to make restitution for the crime that he's committed. Okay, so he has to make restitution for this crime he's committed. And so what will happen is another man comes to the court, and I believe what he'll do is he'll talk with either the single man, or if the man is married, he'll talk with the man and his wife and his children, and he'll say, okay, this is what you've done. This is what the judgment is. This is the restitution you have to make. So, and he may talk with the man and say, okay. He may find out the man's whole background. Well, why did you do this? What were your circumstances? What was your situation? What skills do you have? What type of work can you do? Or are you stealing because you don't have any skill at all? You don't know how to do anything. And after they go through this whole process, they come to an agreement, and the master may say, okay, you come work for me. While you work for me, I will take care if he has a wife and children. Okay, during the time you work for me, I will take care of your wife and your children and provide for your family and pay you, which actually is the money that the master will give to the court to pay off this man's debt for the restitution, right? The master will pay you off the man's debt, and the bondsman will work for the master for this time period to pay you off this restitution that the master's paid the court for him. Okay? And while the bondsman is with the master, if he doesn't have a skill, the master will have him trained in some kind of skill so that when he leaves after the 6 years, he has a skill that he can go and work somewhere or start a business or do whatever he has to do to be able to provide for his family. And so through this means, what is Hashem doing? Hashem is showing this man love. He's giving the man a chance to make restitution. And he's making a way for this man to learn a trade or a skill so that once he's gone through this time period, he can provide for his family and take care of his family. Okay, Angela?
Well, I just looked up the word for servant or right. bondsman, or right. but it actually is a slave. It's Ebed.
Yeah, but it's not like a Gentile slave would be.
I know, but it does, the definition is a slave or a servant.
Yeah.
But I looked at the, it's an ayin, a bet, and a dalet, which the ayin is the eye, or to look, mm-hmm. and the bet is a tent, which a tent or house, from my understanding, always you want to think about study of Torah, because mm-hmm. it's in a house. Yeah. And then the dalet is a way of life or right. a door.
Right, and so the master is giving the bondsman
yeah.
a chance to learn a new way of life. So he's trying to provide for this man and save this family from the condition that they were in the past.
That's pretty cool.
Mm. Okay, so we all see that now? Mm-hmm. So the Lord is actually giving this man a chance, and this is like this 6 year period is probably even something like what we would call like a rehab time, where this person's being rehabilitated from the former life that he lived. Okay, he's going to come out of his past. And when he's done with the 6 years, he's going to be a completely different person than when he came, right? Mm-hmm. He's going to be a follower of Hashem, and he's going to be obedient to the mitzvah. Mm-hmm. Whereas before, what did he do? He was a thief. He broke the mitzvah, right? So the Lord's giving him another chance. The other part here where it says, if he shall, okay, and it says he works for 6 years, in the seventh year he goes free, okay? It says, if he arrives by himself, he shall leave by himself. If he is the husband of a woman, his wife shall leave with him, okay? And that's what we talked about. If he has a family, the master provides for his family during that whole time period. In verse 4 it says, if his master will give him a woman, and she bears him sons and daughters, the wife and her children shall belong to the master, and he shall go out by himself. And actually what they're talking about here, it talks about, actually it gives an explanation of it in the Talmud, is that the only man that the master can give a woman to. He's not allowed to give a woman to a single Jewish man. Okay, because the woman that the master is going to give to this Jewish man is probably a Gentile slave. And they don't want what they talk about here happening in verse 5 and 6. If the bondsman says, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I shall not go free. They don't want that to happen. And so they won't give this woman to a single Jewish man. But what they will do, the master can give him a woman if he's already married to a Jewish woman and he already has children and a family. And the reason they say this is because during the whole 6 years that he's there with his master, his Jewish wife and children are there with him that whole time period, even though the master's given him this other woman. And at the end of the 6 years, the seventh year, when he's let free, he goes with his Jewish wife and his Jewish children, and the master keeps the children that were born to him by this Gentile wife, and she's a slave and she stays there with the master with her children.
But the children aren't raised to be like servants, right? I don't get the...
I don't know.
This is the explanation that they give. And so what they do is the man goes out with his Jewish wife and his Jewish children, and the other ones stay. And this way the man doesn't come to his master and say, I love my wife and my children, I shall not go free. His master shall bring him to the court and shall bring him to the door or the doorpost. The master shall bore through his ear with an awl, and he shall serve the master forever. Okay, and what this is talking about in verse 6, I'll have Angela read it, and this is from the Kumash, and it's the explanation taken from Rashi. Go ahead and read the note on verse 6.
Since the judges were the ones who sold him, they should be involved in the decision to extend his term. The court will attempt to convince the bondsman not to go through with his foolish decision. The court is called Elohim, a word that it also means God, because the court carries out God's law on earth, and because God's presence and influence rests upon the judges. Forever in this context, forever means until Jubilee, the 50th year. The Jubilee marks the end of the entire epoch, as if everything that had occurred before comes to an end and the world begins anew. Properties go back to their original ancestral owners, and all bondsmen go back to their families, even if it is still within the first 6 years after their sale.
Okay, now go back and read the note on verse 5 and 6.
The Torah disdains the bondsman who spurns his freedom and chooses to debase himself by remaining under the patronage of a master and living with his slave companion and children. The ceremony that extends his servitude emphasizes his ear and adore. The sages explain this is in the light of the following. A. God says the children of Israel are my servants, Leviticus 25:55. But this bondsman is also degraded that he has chosen to be the servant of a servant. B, our passage refers to a thief who was sold by the court, as noted above. And C, the doorway symbolizes freedom, for it was against their doorposts that the Jews in Egypt placed some of the blood at the Pesach offering just before they were freed, and this caused the angel of death to pass over the Jewish homes. Chapter 12, verse 22 and 23. Against this background, the sages expound that the ear that heard at Sinai the commandment not to steal, and after stolen had been sold into servitude, spurned the opportunity to go free after 6 years, should be bored with an awl, and the Jew who prefers to be a servant of a human master rather than owe his allegiance entirely to the one master has rejected the lesson of the doorpost in Egypt. Therefore, the boring is done against the door.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so does everybody understand that now?
Mm-hmm.
So the man is supposed to go out with his Jewish wife and children, and that's why they would only give the woman to a man that was already married, so that he wouldn't have that temptation to stay there. Debbie, could you go ahead and read verse 7 through 11?
Yeah. If a man sell his daughter to be a maidservant, she shall not go out as the men servants do. If she please not her master that has betrothed her to himself, then shall he let her be redeemed. To set her under a strange nation, he shall have no power, seeing he hath dealt deceitfully with her. And if he have betrothed her unto his son, he shall deal with her after the manner of daughters. If he take him another wife, her food, her raiment, her duty of marriage, shall he not diminish. And if he do not these three unto her, then she shall go out free without money.
Without payment, right. So what's it talking about here? If a man will sell his daughter as a bondswoman, and actually what he's doing here is he's making a marriage arrangement for his daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And she's going to be with this family, and she's either going to marry the master or one of the master's sons.
Hmm.
Okay. And they say that this time period lasts until the girl reaches the age of puberty. Okay, and then at that time, you know, they'll be coming up to a marriage age, and then she'll be with the person that was designated to be her husband. Okay, so she's basically there working with the master until she reaches puberty. She's in the master's household. But if she is displeasing in the eyes of the master, says he shall assist in her redemption, he shall not have power to sell her to a strange person, because if he does, what that would mean, he's betraying her. Right? Because either she was supposed to marry him or one of his sons, right? Says if he had designated her for a son, he shall deal with her according to the rights of the young woman. Okay, so in other words, they're what? They're under contract for a marriage, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it says if he takes another woman in addition to her, he can't diminish her food or her clothing or her marital relationship. Everything has to be the same as before. Both of them have to be treated equally. And if he does not perform those three things for her, she can leave. So she goes totally free to live her life and go do whatever she has to do. Okay, so it's not like some people think the daughter is just being sold as some kind of slave or something. It's actually a marriage arrangement. Okay, Leonardo, can you go ahead and read verse 12 and 13?
Whoever strikes a man so that he dies must surely be put to death. But if he did not hunt him down, yet God caused it to happen, then I will appoint for you a place where you may run.
Okay. So here we're talking about what, premeditated murder, right?
Mm-hmm.
It says, one who strikes a man so that he dies will be put to death. Well, what, for one who had not lain in ambush and God had caused it to come to his hand, I shall provide you a place to which to flee. And later on in Torah we'll read about the cities of refuge. So if someone is killed accidentally, okay, it's not manslaughter, it's not premeditated, he's not lying in ambush, it's an accident, he can flee to a city of refuge, and the merits of the case are judged by the court. And if the court determines that the death was accidental, the man remains in the city of refuge. He's protected from the avenger of blood. And according to the law, he is to stay in the city of refuge until the death of the high priest, and then he can go free. And that's where what it's talking about, I shall provide you a place to which he can flee. So there's a difference between an accidental death and premeditated murder. Now, if somebody does commit a premeditated murder and he flees to a city of refuge, the court judges the merits of the case and decides that the man has committed premeditated murder and that it wasn't an accident, the court will turn the man over to the avenger of blood. And the man will not be protected by the city of refuge. Okay, Angela, verse 14.
If a man shall act intentionally against his fellow to murder him with guile, from my altar shall you take him to die.
To die. That's the penalty for murder.
Eye for an eye.
Death penalty. And an eye for an eye doesn't mean what you think it does. And we'll talk about that. We'll get there. Okay, Debbie, verse 15.
And he that smiteth his father or his mother shall surely be put to death.
Okay. Now, why is that?
because we're supposed to honor our parents.
What's the what does it say in the commandments? Honor your father and mother.
That it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth.
And that you may live long in the land that I promised you, right? Mm-hmm. So striking a father or mother is a violation of one of the 10 words, to honor your father and mother. It's also representative, because your aunt, your mother and father, your father represents who?
God.
Your father on earth represents your father in heaven. And so striking your father on earth, whom Hashem has given you, is the same thing as if you struck him. And it says here that if the person strikes a mother or father and causes just a bruise, so it doesn't have to be a whole lot of damage either. Okay, verse 16, Leonardo.
Anyone who steals a person and sells him, or is found with him under his hand, must surely be put to death.
Okay, now, who do we know in Torah that was kidnapped and sold?
Joseph,
right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Joseph was kidnapped and sold, and for a time, he was in the power of his brothers, right, while he was in the pit, until they sold him to the caravan that took him down to Egypt, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so actually, according to Torah, Joseph's brothers, what? They kidnapped him and sold him as a slave. And so the penalty for that is actually the death penalty. But in the land of Egypt, what did Joseph do? He forgave his brothers. And it says here in the Rashi commentary that kidnappers are liable to the death penalty only if they forced the victim to work for them and then sold him into slavery. And that's what would get Joseph's brothers off the hook, because his brothers didn't force Joseph to work for them before they sold him into slavery. They just sold him.
Yeah, but they sold him so he wouldn't die in that pit by himself.
So he wouldn't die.
Reuben felt bad about that, so yep. It was a...
Okay, Leonardo, verse 17.
Whoever curses his father or his mother must surely be put to death.
Okay, so it says, one who curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. And we talked a little bit about this before. And the person is death by stoning. And if you get into this a little bit, in verse 15, it says, verse 15, at verse 15 is one who strikes his father or his mother. Okay, we'll go back to that for a minute. Causing a wound or a bruise or a scar, the punishment was death. According to Jarkey, the person who did this, now get this, was sunk into a dunghill up to their knees. And then was strangled with a towel by two witnesses, or two people. In verse 16, the death was by strangling. In verse 17, the death is by stoning. Who are we up to now? Angela, verse 18.
If men quarrel and one strikes his fellow with a stone or with a fist, and he does not die but falls into bed. 18?
Yeah, go ahead and read 19.
If he gets up and goes outside under his own power, then one who struck is absolved, for only for his lost time shall he pay, and he shall provide for healing.
Okay, so if men quarrel and they have a fight, and one of them is injured,
then he pays for his time off.
Then he pays for the man's time off from work and provides for the man's healing. And I'll give you an example of this that happened. It's a true story from a man that I met. He was, the man was on his way to go skiing. The man was a big man, about 6'4", 6'6", weighed close to 300 pounds. Big man, big man. Okay? He pulled into a gas station, filled up his tank with gas on the way to the ski resort. Filled up his tank with gas, went into the store to pay for the gas. The attendant wasn't at the counter. He put the money on the counter to pay the attendant. When he went to go open, when he opened the door, a gust of wind came into the store, blew the money that he had put on the counter for gas, blew it off the counter on the floor. The attendant didn't see the money. Looked at this man and said, hey, you need to pay me for this gas. I paid you. I put the money on the counter. No, you didn't. You didn't pay me. You're ripping me off. And so the man that was going skiing said, no, I paid you. And he turned around to walk out the door, and the gas station attendant ripped his ski jacket off his back. So not thinking, he was furious. This man just ripped his ski jacket off his back. He turned around, boom, punched this man right in the face. When he punched the man in the face, he broke both the man's cheekbones, his nose, his jaw. The man's whole face was caved in. He said he had to pull his fist out of the man's face because it was stuck. Broke every bone in the man's face. And the man that he hit survived. And he made sure this gas station attendant was rushed to the hospital, that the man had proper medical care, that the man was taken care of. And he had to go to court for assault because of what happened to this man. And when he stood before the judge, the judge looked at him and said, well, what happened? And he explained the whole situation, what happened. And he offered to pay all of the man's medical bills and restitution. And the judge agreed with that and let him go. But only because he paid all the man's medical bills and he was paying restitution. That's a true story, and it goes along with what it talks about here in verse 18 and 19. The man went to the court, he covered the man's medical bills and paid restitution. And I can guarantee you that must have cost him a fortune.
Yeah, lots of healing time.
Lots of healing time, lots of medical bills. I guess whatever the man's insurance didn't cover, he had to pay. Okay. Angela, verse, did you read that?
Yeah, I just read.
Okay, Debbie, go ahead and read verse 20 and 21.
If a man hit his servant or his maid with a rod, and he die under his hand, he shall be surely punished. Notwithstanding, if he continue a day or two, he shall not be punished, for he is his money.
Okay, if a man shall strike his slave or his maidservant with the rod, and he shall die, he shall be what? Avenged. It says that what this man is actually, if he beats, okay, this is talking here about a Gentile slave. If he kills the slave, he's actually guilty of the death penalty. It's considered murder. But if the slave survives for a day or two, he shall not be avenged. Okay, so there's no death penalty in that case, for he is his property. And what they did is they used the rod of correction, right, a rod to correct their servants and slaves. But I mean, if you use a rod and you beat somebody to the point of death, that's not correction and discipline. Mm-hmm. That's a major anger issue.
Yeah. You probably ought to seek some counseling.
Yeah. And a slave, even if it's a Gentile slave, should never be treated like that. Because what did it say in Torah? It says, what? You were slaves in Egypt. Remember how you were treated in Egypt? Don't ever treat anybody like you were treated. Mm-hmm. But you're supposed to treat people what?
With respect.
With respect.
Love your neighbor as yourself.
Love your neighbor as yourself. Okay. Yes, you can have discipline, but it has to be done properly. It says if the servant survives a day or two, he's not guilty of the death penalty. But a slave costs the master a lot of money. Mm-hmm. If you think about it, he's got to pay what? Room and board and clothing. If the slave has a family, he's got to take care of all of them. So, and if the slave has any kind of skills that are very beneficial to the master, I mean, the master is causing himself, could be costing himself a lot of money, right? Mm-hmm. Not a smart thing to do. And I would probably say that in a case like this, that if a slave or a servant was beaten and died, that master would probably end up in a long conversation with the rabbi.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. He would be probably get counseling.
Yeah,
and
then some.
This is the old man.
Okay, Leonardo, go ahead and read verse 22 to 25.
If a man fight and hit a pregnant woman so that her child is born early, yet no harm follows, the one who hit her is to be strictly fined. According to what the woman's husband demands of him, he must pay as the judge is determined. But if any harm follows, then you are to penalize life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, and hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, and blow for blow.
Okay. And go ahead and read verse 26 and 27 along with that.
If a man strikes the eye of his male or female slave and destroys it, he must let him go free for the sake of his eyesight. If he strikes out his slave's tooth, he must let him go free for the sake of his tooth.
Okay, stop there. Okay, so you see here, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Okay, here you're talking about a slave. If you strike a slave, that he loses an eye or goes blind in one eye or loses even a tooth, that slave can go free. That slave goes free. Yeah, this is just talking about one tooth. It's not talking about a bunch of teeth. Okay? A tooth or an eye, that slave is set free.
That's pretty serious back then because they didn't have a dentist to replace it.
But what I'm saying here is the rod, okay, when we're talking about a rod back a couple of verses ago, you know, you got to be really careful what you're doing here. Mm-hmm. And where it talks about here, we go back. If men shall fight and collide with the pregnant woman, she miscarries, there will be no fatality. He shall surely be punished, as the husband of the woman shall be caused assessed against him, paid by the judges. If there's a fatality, it's life for life. Now, that's talking about if the woman dies.
Or if the fetus dies. Is it the woman or the fetus?
Well, here it talks in verse 23, it talks about if the woman dies. Okay. It's not the death penalty for the man because he wasn't premeditated, he wasn't meaning to kill the woman. Well, actually, there's different opinions on it according to the sages. But it's not really a premeditated murder. Clear from verses 13 and 14 that only premeditated murder incurs the death penalty. Mm-hmm. So there's a difference of opinion between the sages on that. Some say it's not premeditated murder, some say it is. And the part where it says an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, bruise for bruise. Actually, in that particular case, we're talking about monetary compensation and restitution. So if you injure somebody, You're responsible to take care of that person.
You're not necessarily, if he lost his eye, not you wouldn't necessarily have your eye put out.
No.
You just have to...
You have to pay the monetary value of that eye?
Mm-hmm. And so basically what happens here, you have bodily harm. There's four different types: loss of value, pain, medical costs, and loss of income. And in a situation where somebody's hurt, the judges determine what the situation is. But you're responsible to take care of all of those categories. And there's a fifth payment determined by the sages that they call humiliation. You know, if you injure somebody, you're causing them now, Debbie?
I think I just read it. I think it's
okay, Angela, verse 28 to 32.
If an ox shall gore a man or woman, and he shall die, the ox shall surely be stoned. Its flesh may not be eaten, and the owner of the ox shall be innocent. But if it was an ox that gores habitually, from yesterday and the day before yesterday, and its owners had been warned but did not guard it, and it killed a man or a woman, the ox shall be stoned, and even its owner shall die. When an atonement payment shall be assessed against him, he shall pay as a redemption for his life whatever shall be assessed against him, whether it gores a boy or it gores a girl, in accordance with this judgment shall be done to him. If the ox shall gore a slave or a maidservant, 30 silvers, shekels, shall he give to his master, and the ox shall be stoned.
Okay. Now here it gives an explanation of it. And it says that the ox gored three different times, okay, on three different days, then it was witnessed, and the man was warned three times. Okay, so the man is warned by witnesses three times to take care of this animal. If it gets out again, the man is at fault, and it says the man shall die by the hand of God. It's not a court-imposed penalty. Okay. So all our animals, anybody that has animals, you're supposed to take care of your animals, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we know back around where I live, there's all kinds of cattle. Some of
horses.
And horses. Some of the people have Texas Longhorns. You got to be careful with those.
Yeah.
Or the bulls. I mean, it's. So the farmers.
They have their own little bull farms.
The cattle people have to keep all their fences mended, keep everything good and tight.
Those fences need mending, everybody's fences.
And so, because if somebody gets hurt, the owners of the animals are liable. Now, I will give a personal example.
that horse?
We had my next door neighbor.
Down the road, and not next door.
Yeah, well, lives about a quarter of a mile from me.
Answerable.
He had a herd of horses.
One got out.
No, you actually lost a whole bunch of them one time. And they came into our yard.
And we had about
eight horses in our backyard.
Katie was going to go out and try and do something. I said, don't get out there.
And
those things are bigger than
so what, what the man did, your next door neighbor came over. And he herding his horses down my fence line, down the next fence line, up the next fence line. And they finally got into the road. And
eventually
he managed to get all of the horses back. But, and this was really, really sad thing was that he got the horses back into one end of the pasture. But a half a mile down the other end of the road, at the other end of the pasture, the gates were open. And when he got the horses into the pasture and closed the gate on one side, all the horses took off, ran a half a mile across the pasture and out the gate on the other side.
They just wanted out.
Down the road.
Down the road again.
Down the road again.
And sometimes around here, I think people do funny things to make a story. I call it story
and
making. That's a real
and
story.
And it probably took a bunch of his neighbors to bring them all back and get them back in the pasture.
Okay.
All the horses were all right, but it took a while to round them all up and get
and
them back.
And this happened at night. We couldn't really see them.
You know, the horses were all excited by that time, doing all that running around.
Remember that? It was at night.
And it was at night, too, which made it even harder, because by me there's a lot of wooded areas that the horses could go into. A
couple of ponds for
and
the cows.
And ponds and all kinds of
chicken
things.
Chicken houses, chicken houses.
So it got to be quite an ordeal.
Hay bales.
Says, when an atonement payment was assessed against him, he shall pay a redemption for his life, whatever shall be assessed against him. That's in verse 30. Says, if there are witnesses, the court is required to impose a fine upon him. When the fine is paid, it frees him from the heavenly death penalty. Okay, and if a slave or a maidservant is gored, what happens? It says 30 silver shekels shall be given to the master and the ox is stoned. Okay. Debbie, go ahead and read verse 33 and 34.
And if a man shall open a pit, or if a man shall dig a pit, and not cover it, and an ox or an ass fall therein, the owner of the pit shall make it good, and give money unto the owner of them, and the dead beast shall be his.
Okay, so if an animal falls into the pit and dies or is injured, so that it has to be killed, whoever dug the pit has to pay restitution.
Right. I wonder why he would dig a hole.
People dig holes all the time.
I know they do, but why?
Okay, Leonardo, 35 and 36.
If one man's ox hurts another ox so that it dies, they are to sell the live ox and divide the price. They are also to divide the dead one. Or if it becomes known that the ox was given to violence in the past times and its owner has not kept it penned up, he must surely pay ox for ox, and the dead animal will be his own.
Okay, so that's pretty straightforward there, what it says, right?
That pit can be translated as cistern or well.
Right.
And you're supposed
to keep...
Well, if it's a well, then the water would be in it.
You're supposed to keep a well... Or a cistern covered.
Right.
Okay.
Doesn't mention water, though.
No.
Okay.
many.
Who are we up to now?
Angela.
Oh. Verse 37 to the end of the chapter here.
If a man shall steal an ox or a sheep or goat and slaughter it or sell it, he shall pay 5 cattle in place of the ox and 4 sheep in place of the sheep.
Okay. Now, if a man steals an ox and kills it or sells it, he's going to pay 5 cattle.
I don't know what the significance of is. There's 5 cattle, but he only has to pay for 4 sheep if a sheep's stolen.
Well, think about it. What is an ox used for?
Working. Plowing. Threshing.
Okay, so an ox is a work animal that's used
and
for plowing, for carrying, moving heavy things, pulling carts.
So it's more valuable, I guess.
An ox is a very valuable animal. The sheep or a goat, now of course you take sheep, what do you use a sheep for? You shear the sheep, you get wool, all different things like that. And you have to repay 4 sheep for a sheep. Five times the value of the ox, 4 times the value of the sheep. In addition to the value of the stolen animal, the thief pays a fine of 4 times the value of an ox and 3 times that of a sheep. The Torah reduces the payment for a sheep because the thief suffered the embarrassment of carrying it on his shoulders as he made his escape.
That's funny.
Okay, so we should be, well, you're just saying here that God is what? Merciful and has pity on people and
more than we
compassion. And says that we should be, if God shows pity on a guilty person and compassion on a guilty person, how much more should we show compassion on the feelings of innocent people? Mm-hmm. Right? And I guess, where are we at on our...
It's 8:35.
What time?
Okay, so. Can I shut it off after one ring so it wouldn't bother anybody?
Okay. So do we have enough time to go into chapter 22?
Well,
are we just about out of time here?
We are out.
You got half of the...
Okay.
Depends on how you...
No alarms. Okay, it's
all right. Okay, Bernardo, go ahead. We'll start on chapter 22, verse 1 through 3.
If a thief found breaking in is struck so that he dies, there is no blood guilt for him. But if the sun has risen, there is blood guilt, and he is to make full restitution. If he has nothing, then he must be sold for his theft. If the item is found in his hand alive, whether ox, donkey, or sheep, he is to pay double.
Okay. So the first verse here talks about self-defense, right? If a thief is breaking into your house in the middle of the night and he's struck while he's breaking in and dies, there's no blood guilt. Now, why do you think that is?
Because a owner has the right to protect his property.
Okay, what else?
Well, what if he was climbing over a fence and he fell and died then on your property?
What we're talking about here is that when he's breaking into your house, you have to assume that he's after your possessions, and if he's coming in the middle of the night,
you don't know if he's going to get you and
that,
not care about
that
you.
That he's
enough.
Going to do whatever he has to do to take what he came to get, right?
Uh-huh.
And so you have to defend yourself. It's self-defense.
You don't know if he's going to take you out of
the... But if the man comes in the daytime...
You can see.
And you can see... Okay. It means that the intruder doesn't threaten physical harm. That's according to the Torah. And so in that particular case, it is forbidden for the owner to kill the man. Because the intruder means no physical harm.
But if he does, he has to make full restitution?
But in other words, it says, if the sun shines upon him, there's blood guilt on his account. Okay? It says here that the thief, right, has to make restitution. And if he doesn't have anything, he sold for his theft. If what he steals is in his possession, he has to pay back double. So it's forbidden for the householder to kill if the thief comes in the daytime. What they say also is that in the daytime there would be witnesses that saw the burglar. And if he comes in and kills the householder, he would be apprehended as a murderer, right? So for a thief to break in the daytime, he's not going to harm the householder, because if he does, then there's the threat of the death penalty over him. But breaking in at night is a whole different thing.
Yeah.
They couldn't just turn on the light.
Nope. Okay, Angela, go ahead and read verse 4.
4. If a man permits livestock to devour a field or vineyard, whether he sets loose his livestock or he grazed it in another's field, from the best of his field and the best of his vineyard shall he pay.
Okay. Now we have an example here according to the Torah. What did Abraham do when he was moving his cattle?
Yeah, it was paid when he paid for the grass, didn't he?
Okay, what he would do is he would muzzle all his cattle so that they couldn't go into anybody else's pasture.
And chomp it all down and
nothing. And chomp on somebody else's pasture. And what he would do is he would come to a place and he would talk with the person that owned the field and offer to pay to graze his cattle, or he would go to a merchant and buy feed for his cattle. But he would not let his cattle graze on somebody else's pasture without permission and without paying for it.
Didn't have barbed wire in those days.
And so you wouldn't even know where property lines were at.
Well, they had those little heaps of stones and things.
They had stone markers.
And actually,
they still use those. There's several places around here. Actually, that's what the assessors and everything, when they lay out the property.
When they plot it out,
when the surveyors come, a lot of times there are rocks that they do those plots from.
Perhaps in
concrete
pillars. That they have sometimes in some older places.
Yeah, they have landmarks that they go from whenever they do the survey.
Now they drive a stake in the ground, or a metal rod.
And we had, if you remember, one of the members of our group, Jason, was a surveyor.
Yeah.
And he'd go out and survey all the land.
Those are the sticks, those little pink strands. That's surveyor stuff. Little round things in the...
So, Abraham, according to Torah, to keep the Torah, he made sure all his cattle couldn't graze on somebody else's pasture. And he gave the same teaching to his children, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, who are we up to now? Debbie, verse 5.
If a man shall cause a field or vineyard to be eaten, and shall put in his animal, and shall feed in another man's field.
Okay, one more verse. Verse 6. If a fire,
If a fire break out and catch in thorns, so that the stacks of corn or the standing corn of the field be consumed with it, he that kindled the fire shall surely make restitution. When a discouraged burning, do not burn.
Do not burn.
Burn, okay.
You want to talk about burn, and that's, I had a situation.
We came home again. Quickie example.
The Lord led me to come home, one day led me to come home the
right
back
before I went
way,
to Georgia, right.
The back way from work.
2012.
And as I was coming into my street,
they had the hay bales in the pasture.
I have a hay lot that's across the street from my house that had about 40 or 50 hay bales in it.
And sometimes it's a cornfield.
Apparently, maybe 5 minutes or so before I got there, somebody had driven by and thrown a cigarette out their car window, and it landed in the brush on the side of the road next to the hay lot, and the brush next to the hay lot caught on fire.
And the whole
edge was on fire going east and west and going north and south, burning into the hay lot.
Right near our house, right across the road.
And I lived about maybe 100 yards from that corner, across the street from the hay lot.
And I was leaving the next day.
And so I got scary. To my house, ran in, called 911 to get the fire department.
Had
my wife filling up buckets of water, running them across the street to try and keep the fire down until the fire department got there, because we didn't have any hoses long enough to reach that far.
Our hose thing is in the back, and it doesn't
work. And then one of the other neighbors came over with a tractor and started, one of the hay bales caught on fire. He was able to push that hay bale aside on its own, away from the other hay bales, so we could separate everything. And then the fire department got there and put the fire out.
And thank God they have not put hay bales there since. They put it to corn in the summertime.
But
no more hay.
But that was the situation. Now, I don't believe they ever found the man that tossed the cigarette out the window. But that's where you're talking about. Somebody started a fire. They were negligent. They started a fire. And it almost created a catastrophe.
Yeah.
because all the ground was really dry, it could have created a big, big fire.
Oh, it was in August, early August.
That's a dry time of year, too.
Yeah, it was really, really bad. And so this person here was called to make restitution. But actually, in the scripture, there's a man later on that uses this to annoy Israel's enemies, because there was a man named Samson, and what did he do? He tied together what? The foxtails, and set them on fire and ran them through the field to burn up the enemy's supplies, right? Mm-hmm. I can guarantee you Samson didn't make any restitution. Because he was attacking Israel's enemies.
They had a war going on. All sparing.
Okay, Lenora, can you go ahead and read verse 6 through 8?
If a man entrusts his neighbor with money or items for safekeeping, and it is stolen out of the man's house, when the thief is found, he must pay double.
Okay.
If the thief is not found, then the master of the house is to present him to the court to see whether he has laid his hand on his neighbor's goods. For any transgression, whether ox, donkey, sheep, clothing, or anything else lost, when someone says, "This is mine," the case of both parties is to be brought before the court. The one whom the court convicts is to pay double to his neighbor.
Okay, so now what we're talking about here, okay, something is given to you to safeguard, right? You're supposed to take care of it until your neighbor comes to pick it up, right? Mm-hmm. And if it's stolen by a thief, I mean, you didn't really safeguard it too well, did you, buddy? But if the thief is caught, the thief is to make restitution, pay double what he stole. If the thief is not found, okay, then the man who was safeguarding this property is brought to the court. And in the court, the judges make a decision based on testimony. They make a decision on whether the person safeguarding his neighbor's property, did this neighbor safeguarding this property take it and sell it and basically steal the property that he was to safeguard? Or was it stolen by a thief and the thief hasn't been found yet? And the court has to make a determination
who
on
didn't
that.
Want. Mm-hmm.
And if the man that was to safeguard the property is found guilty, for every item of liability, he has to make restitution. And not only restitution, but pay double if the court finds the person safeguarding the property guilty of stealing the property that he was to safeguard. So we up to Angela now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, verse 9 through 12.
If a man shall give his fellow a donkey or an ox or a sheep or any animal to safeguard, and it died or was broken or was looted without an eyewitness, an oath of a shem shall be between them both, that he did not lay his hand upon the property of his fellow. The owner shall accept it, and he shall not pay. If it shall be stolen from him, he shall pay to its owner. If it shall be torn to death, he shall produce a witness for a torn animal. He does not pay.
Okay. So that's pretty self-explanatory there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So basically, a man gives his fellow an animal, And if something happens without an eyewitness, then the one that was taking care of the animal has to make an oath to his neighbor saying what happened. And he says, okay, I did not lay my hand on your property, and the owner will accept it, and the man doesn't have to pay. That's pretty explanatory, right?
Mm-hmm.
In other words, say I gave Leonardo something, gave him a horse or a cow or whatever, and it's in his possession, he's safeguarding it, and somehow it gets killed, or it disappears, or it gets stolen. He's coming to me and says, okay, this is the story, this is what happened, and it's my responsibility to accept his oath that he's telling the truth and that he's not trying to pull something on me.
Right.
It says in verse 13, if a man shall borrow from his fellow, it shall become broken or die, providing its owner is not with him, he shall make restitution. If the owner is with him, he shall not make restitution. And if he rents it, it comes in return for the rental price.
Hmm.
Okay. Verse 15, Leonardo.
If a man seduces...
16.
15 and 16. If a man seduces a virgin who is not engaged and lies with her, he must pay a dowry for her to be his wife. But if her father utterly refuses to give her to him, he must weigh out silver equal to the dowry for virgins.
Okay, according to the marriage contract. So here what happens says, and in the notes, okay, says that if a man seduces a girl below the age of 12 and a half, he's required to marry her.
Seems a little young.
Yeah.
Well, it says he should marry her, but he's not required to, but he should. Because that's the honorable thing to do, right? Mm-hmm. But and remember now, this woman, this girl is a virgin and has not been betrothed to any other man. Okay, like we talked about before, what a father could sell his daughter before the age of puberty to a master that was actually part of a marriage contract, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is talking about here somebody, a young girl that wasn't betrothed to anybody. There wasn't any contract. But it says, he shall provide her with a marriage contract as his wife. But if the father refuses to give her to him, the man has to weigh out silver according to the marriage contract. And basically what happens in this case is what the man seduced this young girl, and the father's checked this man out and says, This man is no good, and I don't want my daughter marrying this guy. So he refuses to give his daughter to this man. The man is required to pay silver according to the marriage contract.
Mm.
And And according to the law and the sages, the price was 50 shekels of silver. Which is stipulated in the marriage contract for virgins, and it's in the Talmud. Okay, who are we up to now? Angela.
Oh, thought I just read.
Verse 17.
You are not to permit a sorceress to live.
Okay. And I think that is pretty self-explanatory, right?
Mm-hmm.
They say sorcery is what? Sorcery is an attempt to control nature. You remember when Moses was in Egypt and he was with, right? Went up against the magicians and sorcerers of Pharaoh.
Mm-hmm.
Who's in charge of nature?
God is.
Hashem is, right? And sorcery is a very bad thing. And it was used to mislead people all over the world.
Still
is. Worship false gods.
Still is used.
And still is used. And it says, you shall not permit a sorceress to live. If they're found, the penalty is the death penalty. And they are to be rooted out zealously according to the Torah. Because what they do is they seduce and mislead people and get people involved into all kinds of things that are involved with the adversary.
I'm surprised how many people trust in, like, in those kind of things too, and
okay.
Reading cards, and
they have all kinds of things. They've got horoscopes and tarot cards and psychic readings and auras.
Uh-huh.
All kinds of
even your horoscopes. What about that? You know, isn't that a form of sorcery? People read their horoscope. You almost tend to believe that.
Not even supposed to look at that part of the paper.
Mm-mm.
Nope.
It gets folded.
Yeah.
And so those are all things that mislead people and lead people into breaking the mitzvot, basically.
I kind of feel that way about fortune cookies now, too.
Yeah, we never take fortune cookies, yeah.
Because what the enemy does, okay, what does the enemy do? He
comes to
deceives
kill.
A person,
yeah.
and pulls him away from Hashem one little step at a time, one little step at a time, until finally he leads the person from light into darkness.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't even realize it. By the time they realize it, they're so far away.
Yeah, I've heard that. Reading the horoscope. Well, it's just for fun, or it's just.
And the next thing you know.
Entertainment.
And the next thing you know, they're gone, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, because, you know, eventually, whatever you read in there is going to seem like it happens in your life, or, you know, and then you start believing in
that. That's what the enemy does, right? The enemy comes mm-hmm. to what? Lie, cheat, and steal. And do
yeah.
anything he can
to take you
to
away
separate
from
you from Hashem.
Yep.
It's 9:01, Kenny.
Okay.
I don't know when you plan to stop.
Okay. So
you're flashing too.
Okay. I guess we'll have to stop here then. But remember, this Torah portion is about Yeshua.
He saves us from
and remember, stay obedient to the mitzvot.